knows what Linux is?
Linux?
Yes. What's another one? So, Linux is open source. Firefox is also open source. And open source is basically the fact that you can look at how the entire thing was made. So if you want to look at how Firefox works, if you want to understand some really complex thing like WebRTC, you can read the code and you can talk to the person who wrote it. That's what open source is really about. And so we're currently trying to take that concept and grow it a little bit beyond code, because there's a lot of stuff that people can do that's not coding. There's a lot of talent that people have in the community that's not specifically writing code. And so we're trying to figure out how to engage with those people. There's lots of people who want to contribute design and learn how to design with a big team on a big open source project. There's a lot of people who want to try to do marketing and they want to figure out how that works out in the open. There's a lot of people who want to do project management or maybe QA or something like that. And we're trying to figure out ways to build these products. And I think this one in these very open ways. And so we're very truly building software in the open. And I try to say the word producing because it's a lot less about building and it's a lot more about actually conjuring the software. It's hard. And so I'm a producer at the Mozilla Foundation because I have to go everywhere and make stuff happen in order to make software. And it's hard, but it works, and it involves a lot of different kinds of talents. And we try to do it in the open as much as possible, which means like publishing everything that we're doing, asking the community for constant feedback, getting them to contribute wherever possible. There are people who just sort of show up when you have a problem and say, I know how to solve that problem. If you're sort of short on designers and you ask, someone shows up and gives you the design work that you need. Or if you're not quite sure how that weird little thing inside of Android works, you can ask and someone will show up and say, I know how that works, no problem. So we're really, and thanks for the correction, we're trying to build all of the software in the open, but the word software is really enormous. It's not the software, it's the people around it, it's the projects, it's the infrastructure, it's the ongoing engagements, it's everything, and it's huge. So if you're interested in that thing, then it's sort of like a little, like a pet project research thing of mine, and I would be interested to talk to you if you are interested in trying to figure out how to do that super well. Okay, so a bunch of that work though, and we're realizing a lot of this a lot more very recently, is that a bunch of it happens way before you write any code. And it's when you start researching. It's when you go into a community and you talk to people one-to-one, and you say, how do you use X? What's your favorite kind of cat? Like, you ask them lots of questions and get them to show you a little bit about themselves, a little bit about how they approach technology, what they would do with something like any one of these tools, and you write it all down, and you make observations, and you make conclusions which lead you eventually to software. So I think I'm going to get Laura to talk a little bit about that, because she is our researcher, and she's awesome. So just clap.
Hello, everyone. If it's too fast or not understandable. So I am a researcher at the Mozilla Foundation, which means that my job is about asking questions. Today I want to just explain you some things about how we do research and why it's important to do it. The thing that I want you to know is that all of you in that room can be researchers if you want. It's not difficult. So the first thing to know is it's about switching something in your brain. You turn it on. It means that you want to understand the person in front of you. You want to understand why they're here, who they are, where they come from, what is important to them, what makes them happy, what makes them sad, why do they post this picture on Facebook, why do they like this thing on Instagram. If you go into technology, you can ask many, many, many more questions. Because Mozilla Foundation is all about learning, when we do research, we want to understand what people want to learn, what is difficult for them, how they view and understand technology, so that we can say, okay, I think maybe here there's something about privacy that people don't really understand. If we do a bunch of videos, they're more likely to get the message that we want them to get. So this comes from a bunch of conversations that you can do with anyone. I can show you an example of how we did it for WebMaker. So, for example, so as Bobby mentioned, WebMaker is on a mobile phone. So we had so this was made for people to create content on their phone. So we wanted to understand who uses a phone all the time, so obviously everybody, but maybe who has access to a phone only and not a computer. So there you want to understand the population. This was made for Android, and so you need to understand the Android markets. And so if you look at the market penetration, 90% of Android users, occupies 90% of the emerging markets phone usage. This is huge. Half of the world is iOS, half of the world is Android. Because we live in Canada, or I live in London, for example, we needed to understand what it was like to be an Android user in India, or be an Android user in Kenya, for example, so that we could understand how we make the best application for these users. And so the other thing to consider is what we want to do. We wanted people to create. In order to understand this, how you can empower people to create, you need to understand what people want to create. What gets them excited, what makes people happy, what could be a motivation for creating, but also what is difficult about creation. So maybe I'm looking right here. So here, maybe you want to understand what is difficult about creation, but also what is good, so that you can leverage this thing in your product, and you can make sure that the difficulty is solved as well in your product. And so we also wanted to look at different online behaviors, such as sharing. So what motivates people to share a photo, or an article that they saw online, or a video? Any online content gets shared. Sometimes, a lot of people live through sharing information, and they don't create anything. And so you want to understand the relationship between sharing and creating, what is important, what is difficult, etc., etc. So there are thousands of questions. I think the main thing would be to understand how people perceive technology in general, and how they use the internet, how they use their phones, how they use their computers. So we did that in a bunch of countries. Well, this is a picture from Bangladesh. So this man, he lived in Dhaka, in Bangladesh, which is one of the biggest cities in the world today. He has never heard of internet. He doesn't even know what the word means. He uses his phone, but he doesn't even know that something else exists. And right next to him is somebody with a phone like this that costs $100 in Bangladesh as well, that also doesn't know about internet. And this is the thing that Mozilla cares about. How do you teach that person that they could use internet to do some things that they care about, for example. Is it okay until now, or do I speak too fast or too low?
Okay.
So this is where we've been for the past year. So we wanted to research these countries to understand. So as you can see, it's not perfect. We'll be adding something here very soon. The important point here that I want to make is that usually people make a distinction between the north and the south. People have prejudice. They think that in emerging markets, maybe people are late with technology. We went to these countries and we did the research here. But we also went to Chicago and we also did some research in London. And guess what? There's no difference. The understanding of the internet was the same for teenagers in Chicago and teenagers here. Or the understanding was the perception and the mentalities around the internet was the same here and here and here, all around the world. It's pretty global. Of course, there are some differences. Like the price of a phone in Chicago is not the same price of a phone here, which means that they have better devices or a better connection. But if you give everyone the same access to technology, the mentalities were the same. Can you guess why? Okay, it's related to this. Think about a young person in Chicago. What is their first access to technology?
Social media, maybe?
Yes.
Social media, maybe? Like yes. Facebook, Twitter, yeah. Or something else.
Okay.
And then in Dhaka, in the emerging market, maybe they used to. So I think it is same.
Exactly. You are exactly right. The people who go online for the first time today, the first thing they do is create a Snapchat account, Instagram account, Facebook account, and WhatsApp account. And maybe also Vine and Twitter. I think we can drop to 7, the most famous applications. And so the thing is, in Bangladesh it was all about Facebook. In Kenya it was all about WhatsApp. In Brazil it's not so much the same behaviors. In Chicago it was all about Snapchat. But in Brazil, Snapchat people didn't care. Yet the behaviors were the same because it's mobile applications and social media. So what it means is that when somebody comes online, they don't use a lot of internet, various websites on their computers, for example, but they mostly use social media applications. They sort of believe that that's it, that's what it is, that's what internet is. It's the 6th application that we just named. The thing is, it's not just it. Internet is much bigger than this. Everybody can create websites and can make it the web that they want to see. But if people continue to come online on their mobile phones and use 6 applications, then the learning is kind of limited. Usually, when I talk about this, I call it the social media bubble. And so today, people are stuck in here and have like Facebook, WhatsApp, Instagram, and this is all they do. If you talk about Wikipedia, they'll say, oh no, I'm not touching Wikipedia. I heard it's not good. Okay. Thanks. It's made by millions of people worldwide. It's actually pretty amazing and you can create it too. And if you think it's not good, you can change it. But because it's something that's associated with work, it's outside of the fun things, outside of the phone, they don't use resources like this. So anyway, I could talk about this for hours, but the main point is there's not so many differences between what we call developed markets and developing, which I hate to say like this, but to use the current vision of the world. And so it's important to do the research to understand things like this. Now we know when we make either software or programs for people to teach that we can